Put in the most simple terms, If you start with a beam of electrons and you send it into a region that has a magnetic field, the beam of electrons will separate into two beams. This is something that can't really be understood using classical mechanics. We don't understand why some of the electrons should go up and some of the electrons should go down. And in fact, if you could slow the process down and look at individual electrons, what you would see would be each electron would randomly go either up or down, and there's no way that we know. We've been trying to do this for 100 years too as a community. There's no way we know to predict for any given electron which way it will go. So there's my little animation. It goes up and down, and it does this at random. You could keep going forever, and there's just no way to tell. And this creates a puzzle because there's nothing in classical mechanics that tells us this should happen. Newtonian classical mechanics is completely deterministic. If you know everything about the electron, if you measure the electron beforehand, you should know where it's going to go later on. So this points to the idea that we need a completely new theoretical framework for understanding what's going on. Now, obviously, quantum mechanics is a very deep and complicated subject. It's, in a lot of ways, much harder to talk about than special relativity, which is, in some ways, very logical and straightforward. Quantum mechanics is a little bit more complicated, but I'm hoping what I can do for you today is just give you an overview of the basic governing principles. So, suppose you consider... Yes? Consider what the width of the wave is. We call that lambda. It's have it over here. And just to give you a sense, for most objects in the real world, you put these numbers together and you're going to get an extremely small wavelength. For example, the mass of a fairly large person might be about 100 kilograms, and the velocity might be, say, 1 meter per second. I looked it up, the fastest people in the world run about 10 meters per second. So surely the rest of us can go about one. Well, if you put those numbers together, you get basically 100 in the denominator here, and you get 10 to the negative 34 in the numerator. That's 10 to the negative 36 meters. I can't even do that with my fingers. That's a decimal point and then 35 zeros and then, you know, something that's non-zero. That's really, really small. Comparatively speaking, you know, the uncertainty in trying to determine where that person is from just, you know, the fact that your ruler isn't finely grained enough is going to be huge, right? So really, in the sort of classical world, we don't care. But when we start to talk about smaller and smaller objects, particles, we're going to start to really care. Now, if it's true that the particle doesn't have a definite position, what happens when we try to measure position? Well, quantum mechanics tells us that what happens is performing the measurement actually changes the state of the system. There's no way around it. And in fact, measuring the position collapses the wave into a spike that has a definite position. So you start with a system that has no definite position, you measure the position, and the wave collapses. And now the particle is where you measured it. So this is kind of weird and paradoxical, because you want your measurement to tell you something about the system. Well, it has told you something about the system, but it's only told you something about the system afterwards. You still don't know anything about the way the system was before you did the measurement. Performing the measurement says, now I know where the particle is from now on. I still don't know where it was before I did the measurement. So that's a little different. Furthermore, over time, in general, the spike is eventually going to diffuse again, and you'll lose the information about the position that the particle has. Now, we can also think of lambda, the wavelength of the particle, as the uncertainty in the position. It's about, you know, the spread of possible positions that it could have. We might also consider a different quantity, for example, the momentum of a particle, the mass times the velocity. Well, most states, just like with position, most states don't have a definite momentum. They exist with some spread of possible momentum. And you can consider what the uncertainty of the momentum is, delta p. Excuse me. Some measurable quantities cannot be known to arbitrary accuracy simultaneously. Momentum and position are two of these. You cannot know the momentum of a particle perfectly and also know the position of the particle perfectly. And in fact, what we will find is that this is not the exception, this is the rule. You pick any two quantities you might want to measure in the laboratory, and the chances are pretty good you can't know both of them at the same time. It's quantities that you can know at the same time that are sort of the exception. And there's an uncertainty relation that you can write down that basically tells you the uncertainty in the position times the uncertainty in the momentum is greater than or equal to some quantity, and here we see this Planck's constant again showing up. So this basically tells you the smaller this number is, the larger this one has to be to compensate, or vice versa. So the less uncertainty there is in one of these quantities, the more there has to be in the other. Now, if you actually, to tie this back to the conversation we were just having about measurement, if you want to ask particle has changed its state. It no longer has definite position. I could then measure the position of the particle again and might very well get a completely different number. I completely lost all the information I had about position when I measured the momentum of the particle. Now, why is quantum mechanics called quantum mechanics? Where is the quantization in this? Suppose, for the simplest example I can come up with is, suppose you have a particle and it only moves in one spatial dimension and it's confined inside a box of some fixed length. The possible waves that the particle has have to fit evenly into the box. There are my possible waves. And you can see that they all fit exactly evenly into the box. What this does is create a discrete set of possible waves. Now, as you increase the number of wiggles in the wave, you're talking about a state that has larger energy. So what you have is a discrete set of energy states that the particle can have. Now, of course, if you haven't done a measurement, the particle will be in some superposition of these possible waves. But what this says is that if I measure the energy of the state, I have to get one of these numbers. I have to get one of these discrete values. It doesn't, the measurement of energy can't take any value. It has to take one of these fixed discrete values. And the energy states, you can see, are labeled by integers. Basically, you have the length of the box, and you have the mass of the particle, and then you have Planck's constant, and then you have some integer. And you start with the integer equal to 1, and that gives you the lowest possible energy that the particle can have. The longest wave is the ground state for the particle, and any particle in the box has to have at least this amount of energy. It can't have 0. And then, you know, the next possible energy level is with this integer equal to 2, and the next possible is with this integer equal to 3, and so on. Now, what's happening here is that it's the fact that the particle is confined to the box that is giving you this discrete set of values. If the particle wasn't confined spatially, it could take waves of any wavelength, and it would have energy, every possible energy. You wouldn't get quantized energy levels. The generalization of this is that it's the localization of a particle that gives you discrete energy states, that gives you quantization of energy. The case that comes up in quantum mechanics is usually binding one particle to another. So for example, if you have an electron, and it's attached using the electromagnetic force to the nucleus of the atom. It's localized in space. You know it's somewhere close to the nucleus of the atom. And that localization gives the electron in an atom discrete energy levels. I should mention that there's something special about states of definite energy that isn't true of states of definite position, of states of definite momentum, and that's that they persist in time. I said with the states of definite position that over time that peaked wave is going to spread out and you're going to lose the information about the position. Well, a state of definite energy, you don't do anything to the system, it will always have that energy. It's not going to lose the information about energy over time. That's what's special about energy states. So that's a lot of sort of very general sort of principles without a lot of physical phenomena to tie them to. And what I want to do now is talk about a specific physical phenomenon and hopefully tie all of those physical principles into it. And that's spin. Now, a classical object, say a basketball, like linear momentum is the tendency to stay in motion linearly, angular momentum is the tendency of a spinning motion to stay spinning. Angular momentum has a magnitude and a direction. The direction is basically what direction is the axis that it's spinning about, point in. And the magnitude is determined by how fast the object is spinning, how massive it is, and where the mass is distributed. The classic example from, you know, Physics 101 is the ice skater, who has some angular momentum. They're spinning like this. And then if they change their mass distribution, in order for the angular momentum to stay fixed, the rate at which they're spinning changes. So if the person does this, they spin faster. So that's classical angular momentum. We can also think of angular momentum in terms of three spatial components. You can think of it as a magnitude and a direction, or you can think of it as how much angular momentum is there in the x direction, how much angular momentum is there in the y direction, and how much angular momentum is there in the z direction. And that gives you the same, you know, the same information. Then there's this last fact, which is that using the rules of electromagnetism, a charged object that is spinning, that has some angular momentum, generates a magnetic field and will interact with an external magnetic field that is inflicted upon it. This is, yes?
Wasn't that a reason why the electrons will go in different directions? Because they're pointing on that.
Yes, getting there. So what is it that we mean when we say the spin of a particle? The short answer is electrons behave, to all intents and purposes, as if they have some angular momentum that comes from physically spinning. For example, they interact with magnetic fields. Electrons have charge, they spin, they have some angular momentum, they create a magnetic field. In fact, this is what creates natural magnetism. In a natural magnet, what you have is a bar of metal with lots of little electrons in them, and they all start spinning in the same direction, and their magnetic fields add up to some classical magnetic field that you can measure by sticking the magnet to the fridge. However, if you actually calculate how much angular momentum the electron has, and you create an estimate for how big the electron is, and from this you try to figure out how fast it's spinning, what you'll find is that it's spinning faster than the speed of light. That's a problem, because we just spent an hour last week arguing that nothing can move faster than the speed of light. The answer is that it's not really spinning. Spin is one of those quantities that is very difficult to explain. It behaves, to all intents and purposes, as if it is spinning, but it's not. Strange? Possibly. Yes?
If it was, if the size of the particle was smaller than a Planck constant, its speed would be uncertain. And couldn't it spin faster than the speed of light, as far as we know?
So the size of the particle is basically, at this point, going to be that wavelength, the spread, and it's not going to be smaller than Planck's constant. It's going to be larger, in fact. Furthermore, the resolution of the problem is really that it's like the energy levels, where there's a ground state of energy and you can't, no matter how hard you try, get less than this energy. It's a quantization that's going to give you the solution to this. It has to have a quantized value for angular momentum. It's, in some ways, you can think of this like mass. I was thinking about this the other day. We take mass for granted. We think we understand. understand what mass is, but last week I defined mass as the energy an object has when it's isolated from everything else and isn't moving. You can kind of think of spin the same way. Spin is the angular momentum the object has when it's isolated from everything else and isn't moving. Why is one stranger than the other, really? They're not.
One of the previous lectures on string theory made a comment, if I can remember it correctly, was something to the effect that a part of the reason for the origin of string theory came out of this, in the sense that, as he put it, it doesn't make a lot of sense to speak of the spin of a point particle, point meaning a mathematical point, as in point particles of traditional quantum mechanics. And so the idea was that, well, supposing it weren't a point and it were a string. And so he related the whole origin to, at least in part, to this problem.
Actually, that's a very good point, and I probably will come back to this when I start to talk about strings. In fact, the analogy I had with mass can also be tied back to, you know, how strings, you know, produce particles of different masses, and they also produce particles of different angular momentum, and both are because they're extended objects that have some internal structure.
But this seems to speak of the electron as having a size, which is why you have this faster than light, and so you try to eliminate that by making it a point. I guess I'm a little confused on...
You're confused about the difference between saying something is a point particle and saying that it's spread out. So the answer is that if you could perform the measurement of position, you would find the particle at a very specific position. And, you know, as opposed to me, I'm standing here. Am I standing there or am I standing there? Right? But the particle in general has some spread out possible positions, and we think of that as the size of the electron. It's a little strange because I'm not really saying that the electron is a ball with some physical extent. I'm saying you say the size of the electron, what you really mean is, you know, how much spread is there in possible positions for measuring.
In that bell curve spread, is it ever go to zero at a distance?
Depends on if you've confined it to a box, say. In the physical world, no.
Could you hold the questions until after the lecture?
Thank you.
Please.
Okay. Quantum spin. Particles of a specific type will always have the same quantized value of the magnitude of angular momentum that they have. And this magnitude of total angular momentum is labeled by half integers. For example, we will say that an electron or a proton or a neutron is a spin 1/2 particle. And that refers to the total angular momentum that it has. Photons are spin 1 particles. They have more angular momentum. They don't have charge, so they don't create magnetic fields, but they do have angular momentum. Spin 2 particles, gravitons are spin 2. We will also meet a spin 0 particle, a particle with no intrinsic angular momentum later on. The Higgs particle has spin 0. Now, while the total magnitude of angular momentum that a particle has is fixed just by knowing what kind of particle it is, the direction that this angular momentum will go in is not fixed by particle type. If you think in terms of the three spatial components, x, y, and z, then measurements of the amount of spin in a given spatial direction, and it's very traditional to use the z direction, are quantized and give two possible values. This is what people generally refer to when they say spin up and spin down. An electron, if you measure its angular momentum in the z direction, happening, because you can also measure the spin component in the y direction, and you would also get two possible numbers. And so we could refer to that as spin up in the y direction and spin down in the y direction. But most people associate up and down with z. So that's a little icky. And for that reason, I usually just use plus and minus. And here we have another case of the uncertainty principle, because it turns out that the component of angular momentum in the three directions satisfy an uncertainty principle. You can't know how much spin in the x direction it has and how much spin in the z direction it has at the same time. These are another set of quantities that you can't measure simultaneously. Now, if we go back to the Stern-Gerlach experiment and think about how this informs the Stern-Gerlach experiment, we see that what's going on is the electrons are being affected by the magnetic field because of their angular momentum and their charge. The direction of deflection depends on the component of spin along the direction that the magnetic field points in. So if we have the magnetic field pointing in the z direction, then the deflected particles that go up have spin up, and the direction, or plus, and the particles that go down have minus in the z direction. Now, initially, the electrons didn't have definite spin in the z direction. They existed in some quantum superposition of possible states. It's the magnetic field, subjecting the particles to the magnetic field, is performing a measurement of the z component of spin. That's what you're doing. And once you've done that, I think I just lost my, there it is. Once you do that, the electrons are forced into a state of definite spin in the z direction. So that's why you can't a priori know which way any given electron is going to go. It doesn't have definite spin in the z direction before you do the measurement. It only has definite spin after you do the measurement. Now we can extend this, as somebody was suggesting that we do. Excuse me. Suppose we start with the incoming electrons, and then we subject them to a magnetic field pointing in the z direction. We get the two beams out, and we throw away one of the beams. So we select for the particles that have plus in the z direction, and then we subject them to a second magnetic field. Well, if the second magnetic field also points in the same direction, we started with a beam of particles of definite spin in the z direction, so the measurement can only yield one possible value, right? So we don't get two beams out, we just get the same one beam. That's because the beam coming into the second field has a definite spin in the z direction. Well, we don't have to have the second magnetic field point in the same direction. If instead we have the second magnetic field point in the x direction, well, it's certainly true that the beam of electrons we have going into this second magnetic field have definite spin in the z direction. But as I just said, these are quantities that you can't know simultaneously. If you know the spin in the z direction, they can't have definite spin in the x direction. So you subject them to this second magnetic field, and you must get two beams. And one of these beams now has definite spin in the x direction plus, and the other has minus. The second magnetic field is measuring the spin in the x direction. Well, we can create a little tower here. If we subject the beams one more time to a third magnetic field, so we start with the incoming electrons that have no definite spin, and then we measure the spin in the z direction, and we get the two beams of definite z spin. We throw one of them out, and we subject the remaining beam to a magnetic field in the x direction, and now we get the two beams of definite x spin, and we throw one of them out, and we subject the remaining one to a magnetic two beams again. Why do we get two beams? Because when we did this, when we measured the spin in the x direction, we destroyed the information we used to have about the spin in the z direction. It doesn't seem like it makes sense, because you measure one quantity, then you measure another quantity, and then you measure the first quantity again and it's different. That's very not classical, and no classical reasoning can explain this. Classical reasoning says, well, okay, I'll buy the fact that the electrons are spinning, and I'll buy the fact that the magnetic field is affecting them, and I'll just say that I didn't know what direction they were spinning in before because I hadn't done the measurement. Well, classical reasoning says, fine, okay, but I should get a spread of possible, you know, the beam shouldn't separate into two beams, it should separate into like a range. Because classically, you'd expect that the particles are spinning in all possible directions. Yes?
Are the beams of the same intensity?
Those two beams?
Yeah.
Yes.
And the others as well?
Yes. Well, even if you buy the fact that it separates into two definite beams, classical reasoning says, I've thrown out the ones that are, you know, mostly spinning negative in the z direction. Now I have only particles that are mostly spinning positive in the z direction. And then I do the second thing, and now I throw out the ones that are mostly negative in the x direction. Classical reasoning says that this beam has both mostly positive in the x and mostly positive in the z, and that performing this measurement should really only give you one beam. Classical reasoning is wrong. You can actually go into a laboratory and perform this experiment, and this is what you get. Quantum mechanics, we don't believe in quantum mechanics because it's cool, or because it's weird, or because we want to feel smarter than everybody else. We believe in it because you actually go into the laboratory and this is what you get. We don't have a choice. And I just throw this last thing in. The result would stay the same even if you took these two beams and you mixed them together again. Even if you, you know, threw these two together and then subjected them to the magnetic field in the z direction, you'd still get the two beams out. It's the act of performing the measurement that by itself has changed the state of the system. And that's sort of the last nail in the coffin as far as the Newtonian ideal of experiment goes. Because according to the Newtonian ideal, the observer sits on high and doesn't affect the system at all, it just takes notes. Quantum mechanics tells you it's not just a matter of being a better scientist. You can't be such a great scientist that you don't change the state of the system by observing it. Not possible. Now, Planck's constant is this number h, which has been sort of running through these slides, gives us the scale of quantum mechanical effects. The same way the speed of light gave us the scale of special relativistic effects last week. Suppose we could stand outside the universe, and I love imagining this. I'm standing outside the universe with a bunch of dials and godlike powers, and I can change all the constants of nature. If I could set Planck's constant to zero, I could get rid of quantum mechanics. If you go back, this wavelength, if you set the Planck's constant to zero, the wavelength goes to zero. So all of those waves of possible positions collapse into particles with definite positions. The uncertainty relation disappears because this side of it goes to zero, and now you're just saying that the uncertainty in position times the uncertainty in momentum is positive, which is obvious. Uncertainties are always positive. So you can know any two quantities infinitely well just by being such a good experimenter. The quantization of energy levels smooths out. If you see this H in the numerator, it's determining how widely spread these energy levels are. And if I decrease H to zero, change what Planck's constant is. But if you're thinking about measurements that are large compared to h, then h is very close to zero, and to all intents and purposes, you can ignore quantum mechanical effects. So we can create this graph, and here we have the classical world, where we have large objects that are large compared to Planck's constant, and we have objects that aren't moving very fast, slow speeds compared to the speed of light, and this is where Newton lives. As you increase your speed, you have to take into account relativistic effects. As you decrease your size, you have to take into account quantum mechanical effects. Particle physics, generally speaking, lives here, where we have to take into account both kinds of effects. We have very small objects moving very fast. So, I'm just going to review some of the things that I've said. In general, particles don't exist in a state of definite quantity. Position, momentum, energy, spin, whatever it is that you're interested in measuring, in general, the particles aren't going to have a definite value before you measure it. If you measure the quantity, you change the state of the quantity and you force the particle into a state of definite value. Excuse me. Many quantities, the most classic example of which is position and momentum, but also different components of spin, can't be known simultaneously. And the more accurately you know one, the less accurately you know the other. Furthermore, we saw that it's the localization of a particle in a given region of space that gives you quantized energy levels. Finally, particles possess intrinsic quantized angular momentum, and Planck's constant determines the scale where quantum mechanical effects become important. Now I have to stop talking. Amount of power. it does is if you assume that the light has to be given off in these quantized values, you produce the experimentally observed curve. That's where Planck's constant first showed up.
Measurements that we have already performed and to be
then you know nothing about its momentum. It's the quantization that tells you that there's a finite amount of energy that you can have. That's the energy levels get quantized, and then there's the longest possible wave that can fit in, and whatever that the energy is that's associated with that longest possible wave, the particle must have at least that amount of energy.
Like the graph that I showed you
because when particles are not accelerating.
But we need a place to the principle of gravity.
Gravity, any force is going to create accelerations, and special relativity is going to start to break down. Gravity is special when it comes to accelerations because, as we'll see later on, it's impossible to tell the difference between an accelerating object and an object in a gravitational field.
Are you going to post the slides?
Hopefully, yes.
This goes back to an earlier question. I'd be surprised was expressed over the fact that making a question about something that affects its state. I have to turn that around and ask you why you would assume that it doesn't affect its state. Every measurement is an interaction.
This is true. I mean, speaking as a 21st century physicist, I don't. You would have to ask somebody who was living in the 1860s why they assumed that taking... It wasn't that they assumed that they personally weren't affecting the state of an object. They were assuming that it was because they were an incompetent scientist at some level. They were assuming that if they could just be a better scientist, they could take the measurement without changing the state of the system. Do you see the distinction I'm making? Whereas quantum mechanics tells you that... Quantum mechanics tells you that there's no way to do better.
Now, I guess that if you have a car running at a certain speed, and you want to, you can calculate its momentum, and you probably could see what it is by putting a light detector, and when the thing cuts the beam, you know that it was there. But can you stop the car and measure the momentum at the same time that you measure what it is?
That's a classical.
Classically, yes, because the uncertainty and the momentum and the position are going to be teeny tiny compared to your laboratory equipment. But yes, it is still there.
I've been imagining the pictures I've seen of CERN with the big measuring equipment. Now I'm troubled about what they're measuring. And then all that, those big things are trying to measure the accelerator experiments are measuring, therefore they're affecting.
Yes.
And I really like your split beam explanation showing that by measuring, I mean by doing the second measurement, Z, X, you create uncertainty about Z again, so you get split beam the second certain time around. Do you have any easy metaphors for us laymen about how this stuff in CERN and doing all that measuring is?
How
that kind of thing, is it revealing uncertainty or is it revealing information?
I'll tell you what. I'm going to spend all of next week talking about accelerators and what we actually measure them. So, I mean, and that's part of why I set it up this way. I spend the first 2 weeks telling you what we can't measure, and then I spend the third week telling you what we actually do.
And what we said to Nikki is the cost of those accelerators is way up.
That's certainly true. Yes?
Kind of going in the other direction. I've always been a little bothered by what constitutes a measurement, because we are huge, sentient, intentional beings, setting up these complicated apparatus to do a measurement. But isn't any collision between particles also a form of measurement that, might not have its intention?
Yes.
And does that imply a decay of stuff that we have measured because there's everything else doing measurements too to mess up?
Yes. I think that what you're getting at is... it's complicated to separate, the measurement from the physical system in the real world because, apparatus are made of atoms and atoms fly around and whatnot. I mean, obviously, when I talk about these things, I sort of imagine these rarefied ideas. In the real world, you're quite right. The collisions of particles do, in themselves, constitute measurements of a type. actually measure the, you know, something about a particle. What you're really usually doing is, for example, if you're looking at it, you're sending photons at it. And the photons are interacting with the particle. And that's exactly what you're saying, right? When we measure the particle, what we're really doing is creating particle interactions. That's a very good point.
That's correct.
So it's the other way around, yeah. and it was violated, which
yes.
says that there is, but it doesn't violate causality. It says that that particular type of hidden variable